Welcome to part 8 of this 12-part Python tutorial series for beginners. In this chapter, we're going to learn about tuples and sets in Python, which are two extremely useful data structures. You already know about lists and dictionaries, and so now we're going to add two more data structures to your toolbox, which will enable you to solve an even wider range of problems. Tuples in Python are immutable sequences of elements. So this is what the syntax looks like. It's actually quite similar to lists that we saw in a previous chapter, and you can even access elements in the same way by using these square brackets and then putting in the number, which is the index of the element that you wish to access. The difference between a list and a tuple is that after a tuple is created, its elements cannot be changed. You can't add, remove, or update elements inside a tuple. So that's what the word immutable means, unable to be mutated. So far, tuples just sound like a less useful version of a list. So why should we use it? Well, it turns out that there are some advantages. First, it's more efficient. If you know that the size of your tuple is going to be fixed, then you don't need to provision for adding items or removing items. Number two, you can actually use a tuple as a key inside a dictionary. You can use a list as a key. In fact, you can use any mutable data type as a key of a dictionary, but a tuple you can. So that's useful if you need a composite key, so a key that's made up of two elements. And a very typical example of this is that you want a dictionary to represent a grid, and you want to have X and Y positions as your key. So instead of turning that into a string or figuring out how to turn that into one object, you can use X and Y as a tuple, and that can be a key for your dictionary. And last but not least, they're safer because they are immutable. So the fact that you can't modify a tuple after it's created gives you certain predictability to your code so that you don't accidentally change or modify things later on, which reduces the chance of introducing an accidental bug to your program. If we know the size of a tuple beforehand, which we usually will because it is immutable, we can also unpack it into separate variables directly, rather than using an index to access it. So you can see in this example here, first I create a tuple with two elements, 1 and 2, inside that tuple. And like the list, we can access it with the index. So you have x equals my tuple and then 0, and you can do that, and that's fine. But if you already know how many elements there are inside your tuple, you can do something like in the second example, where you use commas, so x, y, z equals, and then your entire tuple. And that will unpack each of those values to the respective variable on the left-hand side of that expression. So x will be equal to 1, and then y will be equal to 2, and z will be equal to 3. So that way, you don't need to use indices at all, and you can pretty much unpack all your variables into one line. This technique is called unpacking or spreading, and it's just another example of Python's syntax sugar. Because of this unpacking technique, it's actually quite common for Python functions to return tuples as a data type, and it makes the code more readable and easier to understand. We've actually already been using something like this already. Remember this items function from when we were iterating through a dictionary from the previous chapter? This items function actually returns a tuple on each iteration, but instead of dealing with a tuple and then using the index to access the values, we unpack it in that line into two separate values, a key and a value, so we can use those as named distinct variables. Now let's quickly go over to our code editor just to get our hands on with the tuples as well. So to create a tuple, just type in the name of your variable, for example, my tuple, and then we can put in any data we want here. So now I've created a tuple with a couple of pieces of fruit as my data. So I've got 3 elements, and now let's try to access the data inside this tuple. So I'm gonna print my tuple, and then if I run that, you'll see that the entire tuple is printed out. And now if I want to print a particular element, I can use an index, like in a list. So 0 will access this item here. And then if I print out 1, my tuple 1, it will access this second item. So now let's try unpacking a tuple. To unpack a tuple, we need 3 variables, since there's 3 elements in here. And it always has to be equal. And then you can just use the assignment operator, and this will unpack the tuple into these values. So let's run that, and then let's print out these values as well. So now I have the cherry being stored in X, and then if I print Y, I should get the kiwi, and then if I print Z, I will get the banana. And also the names don't have to be X, Y, Z, they can be anything you want. So for example, I could call it cherry, kiwi, and banana. So that's how you unpack a tuple. Now you need to make sure that the number of variables that you try to unpack it into is equal to the elements inside this tuple. Because if it's not and you try to run that, it's going to fail with a value error. If there's certain values you don't care about, for example, let's say I only care about the first two items of the tuple, but I want to unpack it and I don't care about the last one. In Python, it's conventional to use an underscore to express that I need to unpack this, but I don't care about what this item actually is. So you could do something like that. And now this will run and it won't complain. And if someone's reading your code and they see this, they know that, okay, you just need this to unpack it, but you don't intend to actually use it. You could also use a tuple as a key inside a dictionary. So let's see an example of that really quickly. Let's say we were building maybe a 2D grid or a chessboard or something like that. So I'm gonna call this board. And I wanna know if a certain square is occupied or not. So if there's, it's either empty or it's not empty. So instead of making it a two-dimensional list, let's say I have a huge board and I only want to look up certain squares, it's better to store it as a dictionary. So let me create this as an empty dictionary. And now I can create an item in the board using a tuple as a key. For example, let's say that a position 1-2, or maybe to be more clear, 1-1. So this is like one of the first squares on the board. I can set that to a value. So it could be true to say that it's occupied. There is something on that item. So I can set it to true to say that it is occupied. There is something on that position, and anything else is false. So now let's see, I want to check a certain position. Let's say I have another position that I want to check, and that position is maybe 3-4. So column 3, row 4, or whatever. Now I can actually do this. If position in board, return board position. If position in board, print the board position. So I'll have that printing true or false. Otherwise, if it's not even in the board, I'll make it print false. And so if I run that, because this key is not in the board, it's false. Whatever the state is here, it's not true for this position. But I can actually add that. So I can actually do board 3-4 equals to true. And now if I run it again, it'll say that it's true. So as you can see here, it's pretty situational where you would use a tuple as a key, but it's usually in situations where you want to access something inside a dictionary, but your key has to be composed of multiple values. So just keep this in mind. If you ever need to do that, tuples are gonna be the tool that you can use to do this. Sets are another very useful data structure in Python. It's another way to store a collection of items where the order doesn't matter, and you can't have duplicates, but you can easily check if something is in the set or if it's not in the set. So let's go back to our editor, and here's an example of a set. It's very similar to a list, except that instead of the square brackets, we've got these curly brackets, and you can't actually have duplicate elements in a set. They're all going to be unique. So this set is called favorite fruits, and let's just print it out to see. So I'll hit run. And then you can see it's printed out over here and all the items are there. If I try to add a duplicate element, for example, I add this banana here twice. Let me run that again. You could see that it doesn't actually add a new banana. There's only one of them in there. Another thing you can notice is that the items when you print it out aren't in the same order that we specified it in. So let me run this again. You could see here the blueberry is actually third. So it's swapped with the banana. And then every time I run it, you can see that the items come out in a different order. That's because in a set, the ordering of items doesn't matter. It's only what's in the set that matters. Now, we also have inbuilt functions with a set to add and remove items. So let's say that we have our set here already, and we want to add a new item. We could do that like this pretty easily. So the name of the set, dot add, and then just put in the item that you want to add. So here, let's add a kiwi fruit. And now if I run that again, I'll see that my set has a new fruit added to it. But if I try to add something that I already have, for example, let's try to add the blueberry here, although it already exists in the set, and see what happens. It doesn't fail, so if you try to add something, a duplicate item to a set, it won't cause an error, but nothing will happen. The set will just continue to have one copy of that item. And you can also remove items from a set. For example, instead of this add here, let me change that to remove. And then if I run that, my set now has the blueberry removed. We've already learned a couple of different data structures, lists, dictionaries, and tuples. So you might be wondering, what are sets useful for and what problems do they solve for us that we don't solve with the other data structures? Well, an easy way to think about it is that it helps us solve any problems that look like a Venn diagram. So this here is a Venn diagram and you have two groups of items and you want to find if something that you're looking for is in one group or the other group, or if there's items in common between these two groups, or if there's items in either of the two groups that you care about, things like that. That's because it's really easy to check if something belongs inside a set, and it's also easy to check for overlaps or intersections with other sets. If we want to check for overlaps, this is called an intersection. So that's the area where two sets have items in common. If we want to look for items that belong in either of the sets, that is what we call the union of the set. So it's kind of like those two sets added together. And sometimes we might even want to find items that exist in either of the sets, but not in both. So this is called the difference. And here we will have to find items that exist either in set A or set B, but not in both A and B. So we could do that as well. Now let's go back to our editor and see some of that in action. For example, I've got my set here called favorite fruits, and I want to check if a particular item is inside the set at all. To do that, I'll create a value that I care about. For example, let's put an apple, and now I can do apple in favorite fruits. And this expression will return a Boolean. So if I print that, it's either going to be true or false. And then it's false because apple is not in this set. But if I change this to a banana and then I run it again, this is going to be true. Although we're printing this now, this is just an expression. So we can actually take that out and store it inside a variable as well, like that. So result equals banana in favorite fruits. Well, it's still true because that banana is there. Now let's take a look at how we can find an intersection of two sets. To demonstrate that, let's imagine we have another set called red fruits, and I want to find fruits that are in common between both sets. And if you remember from before, that's what we call an intersection. So here I will find a set of favorite red fruits. And the requirement is that it's a set of fruits that are both in my favorite fruits and also both red. So we can do that using the inbuilt intersection method. And you can use it like this. So type the name of your set, then dot intersection, and then pass in the name of the other set you wish to intersect it with. And now if I print this favorite fruits, we should see that it has the intersection of them. Okay, so now it's printing out cherry and the watermelon, because those are the only items that are in common between both of these sets. And there's also the union method, which combines the members of two sets. So if we change that to union instead, and then we change this one to all fruits, if I print that out, now I'm going to get the union of both of these sets. So if I run that, you'll see that every single fruit between these two are represented inside this result. And finally, there was the difference or the subtraction method that I was talking about. So that's if we want to find things that are in here, but not in here. It's almost like a subtraction. So let's try that. And I'm going to call this favorite fruits, but not red. And this is going to be equal to my favorite fruits. And we could do difference and we'll take the red fruits out. So let's print favorite fruits, but not red. And if I do that, you'll see that all the red fruits have been removed from my favorite fruit set. And that is the result. So as you can see, sets are really useful for when you have to deal with collections of items where the order doesn't matter, but duplicates matter and checking for membership and things like intersection and union of those items matter to you. So just keep that in mind if you come up across situations like that. Now, as usual, let's wrap up this chapter with a coding exercise to practice what you've learned. So for this exercise, I want you to imagine that you are creating an application that helps your user find a restaurant according to their food preferences. And you have a set of your user's favorite foods. So here, our favorite foods are a burger, pizza, and shrimp. And you also have a dictionary of different restaurants. So this is the name of the restaurant, and here are the foods that they serve. So for this app, I want you to write code that tells you which restaurant is the best match for the user. And in this case, the answer should be Hungry Jack's because we have two items in Hungry Jack's that matches, whereas the other restaurants either have zero items or only one item that match. So you want to pick the restaurant that has the most matches. And if you find certain restaurants that have an equal number of matches, then it's up to you which one you want to recommend. And feel free to change some of these values just so that you can try it out with different logic and make sure that it still works. To successfully solve this problem, you also need to apply some of the other knowledge you've learned so far in this course, especially things like loops and dictionaries. So if you get stuck, go back to those videos and check them out as well. Otherwise, pause the video and try to solve this problem, and once you're done with it, or if you get stuck, you can resume this to see the solution. Welcome back. Now I'll go through my solution for this problem. So you've got the same starter code here with the food preferences and the restaurants. The first thing we're going to want to do is create some variables to keep track of the best matching set of foods that we've seen so far, and also the best restaurant name that corresponds to that set of food. Because what we're gonna do is we're gonna go through each of these restaurants and then check what are the items that we have in common with our preferences. We're gonna compare it to the best one we've seen so far. And if it's better, we'll remember it and that will become the new best one. And we'll continue that until we run out of restaurants to search for. So this should work with three restaurants, but if our list had a million restaurants, it should still also work. So once we have these two variables to keep track of that, we can start looping through all the restaurant items. And we need that because we need both the name of the restaurant, which is the key in this dictionary, but also the value, which is the set of foods. In each iteration, I'm going to find the common foods. So I'm going to use the set intersection method between my food preferences and the restaurant's menu items. And that will give me a subset, like a smaller set of items that are in common between the two. Then I'm going to use the length function to check if the number of items in my overlapping common foods here is better than what I've seen previously. If it's the same, it doesn't beat it. So what will happen in my program is that we will get the first restaurant that has the highest matches. So if we get two matches here, in the case of Hungry Jack's, if something comes along that has two matches as well, that will not replace the first match that we had. So that's just, you know, there's no reason why that is right or wrong, but that wasn't in our spec. So that's why I just did it that way. So when we compare the length and we get something that looks better than what we've seen before, we will remember it and store it in the best match foods and restaurants. And by the end of this loop, we will have the best restaurant and the best matched foods being printed out. So if I run that, you can see that here it does give us this restaurant, Hungry Jack's, with the burger and the pizza as the best matches. Now, if I change my food preferences, let me say just copy these and add these to my preferences. So a bit of a healthier preference there. And I run that, you'll see now that the best restaurant has changed because I have three matches in the last restaurant now instead of two. But if I remove this bread and just leave these two items and I'll run that again, it's going to go back to this fast food one because it needs more than the previous number of matches in order to replace. So yeah, that was one way to solve this problem, but there are multiple ways you can solve this problem. So if you manage to solve it and you have a very different solution, then let me know in the comments. So now I hope you feel comfortable using tuples and sets in Python. See you in the next video where you'll learn about functions, which is probably the most important concept to understand, not just in Python, but for programming in general.